Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. Before we get started, I would love to pass it off to Jared, who's going to give us a formal acknowledgement of the land and of the people of this land, both in an indigenous Salish dialect, as well as Maori and English. After you, Jared.
Hesul Halpetsia, Chinlept Uchinye, Chlutesk Asip, He Uclisten Hamanestulius, Puta in Krusten, Homena in Quokulten who milk stulu, Namnunch Petsia. Tihe Maudiora. Te mihi tuatahi katukuna atu ki a papatu anu koe takoto iho nei iru ni te hauwoto whaari ki tapu. Tēnā koe. Tuarua. Ki te mana whenua o tēnei rohe a tuake nei iru ni iaia. Tēnā koutou. Tuatoru. Ki a tātou e noho nei e huhi mai nei tēnei wā. I rauru i te koro ai kotahi. Tēnā koutou. Ko mātā atua, ko nuku tere nā waka. Ko mauna pohatu te mauna. Ko taurana te awa, ko tūhoi te iwi. Ko te whakatāne te hapu. Ko tauanui te marae. Ko te waimana kāku te au kaipō. No te whānau hia ki tā hau. Tēnā koutou.
Well, that was a bit of a mouthful. First and foremost, I just want to acknowledge everyone who is gathering here today from across the world on these sacred lands of the Spokane people. And we all come from sacred lands, we all live on sacred lands, and we bring that life force with us here today. And that's what's going to galvanize us moving forward. And on that note, I'm going to save the introductions for the filing proceedings. So thank you very much. It's very wonderful to be here.
This year's conference theme is environmental education, a force for the future. How do you see or understand your work to impact the future in this field?
Well, I'll start again. What I think is really fascinating actually is, and especially having so many conversations here, is that many people are understanding the importance of, instead of habit-based changes, but value-based changes. And so, like, adding on to what Taiji said about connection and what we're talking about the importance of changing the way we approach different communities. What I really like about the focus of this conference is how informal education and how different ways of reaching people is incredibly important, because it's not just important that we have diversity and inclusion because it's the right thing to do, but we also need to be able to reach as many people as possible because this is a global issue and we need global leadership and global participation.
Thank you.
And building off what Denise said, I think the keynote speaker, Brady Watkinson, he had shown a diagram of kind of what creates cultural change and kind of what sets that off. And he brought up the fact that it's really a point when people start feeling like they personally know someone. So the importance of building strong personal relationships grounded in what is sincere to you, I think is the start. And so when we focus on huge issues like climate change, environmental issues, at the same time, we know that they are social issues. If we're going to create change, it starts with these personal connections, personal relationships. And that is kind of what environmental educators do best. We deeply care about what we're teaching about, and we share our own passion and enthusiasm and interest with our audiences. But I would challenge us to really respect the fact that if we're going to have environmental change, we need to start with social relationships, relating to the kids in a genuine way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you want to go, Joe?
I'd just like to add to that, please, Taiji. I just finished talking about the indigenous perspective and how you kind of have a shortcut to a meaningful relationship with the environment, because you build this personal social connection. So, you know, when you might talk about a tree and you might see a healthy tree, maybe from an indigenous perspective, it's a happy tree. if it's a tree that's dying, this tree is sad, you know, it's sick. So it's about changing the dialogue to make it more personal. And I don't think that's something that's exclusive to Indigenous people. I think we can all engage in that conversation.
Barbara, did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I think just on the theme of diversity and equity and inclusion, I think often, you know, we see our role as a group or with underrepresented groups
as passive recipients.
Often underrepresented groups are seen as passive recipients as opposed to drivers of change. So sometimes I feel like we're looking for what we can do to help underrepresented groups when we could change our frame to look at what underrepresented groups and members of those groups have to offer to the solution of the problem. And I just, you know, we miss out on what they have to offer, and they hold some information that we may not have in the mainstream. Okay.
I want to open this up to more of us to discuss. What do you think you bring, and your communities, and how can we center the communities that we come from in this field?
It's obvious that diversity and inclusion are important values of this organization, of probably all the people here. I share that value. And on Thursday night, it dawned on me that probably the most significant way that I can represent that is by acknowledging the local people here in their own language. So on Friday morning, I got on the phone. I employed the uses of Google to find the Spokane Language Center. I called them up and I asked them if that would be appropriate. They were very appreciative and very obliging. I was sent a recording to just sort of try and learn off by heart. I really didn't want to have to read it, but it was hard. So I guess what I'm getting at is that that was the most important way that I could represent what diversity and inclusion means. And it wouldn't matter if there were no Native American people in here, great if there are, but I'm expressing a representation of diversity through my act. And that's sort of my challenge to us moving forward, is that we go beyond putting bums on seats and having people participating, but we open up our minds to allow those people that we're inviting in and the various cultures and languages that they're bringing. Let's be open to allowing those things to permeate throughout our practice. And to me, that is a true representation of what diversity and inclusion is, because the movement that we are part of, saving the world, which to me is a bit of a false statement, the world doesn't need saving, we need to save ourselves. And we need to figure that out in a way, you know, that we can sort of exist in equilibrium. But in order to do that, there's going to be a big need for people to come together. And it's going to take young people and older people to be really bold. Just like we need bold action in climate change, we need really bold action in inclusion and diversity.
So anyone else, you know, like kind of speaking to like the on the ground work, you know, so like right now we kind of focus a lot on, you know, more conventional, you know, education in the schools or outdoors education. So if we sort of have like different perspectives being incorporated into the field, like how do you think that's going to shape the nature of organizations and our work on the ground?
I'm really conscious that when students are participating in my program, they roll up in their bus, chances are they're not expecting to see a person like me. So one of the great things about an event like this, where you're putting a diverse audience or a diverse group of speakers on stage, there's a lot for representation. I think, for me, if a kid shows up, I know that if they've never met an Asian environmental educator, they're going to be surprised and they're going to be happy, because when I saw Asian people in the outdoors, frankly, Pittsburgh has like not a whole lot. So when I come out to the West Coast, it still feels like a big deal for me, and I'm 30. So I think representation is huge, but a lot of times when we're thinking about diversity, equity, and inclusion, we think it stops with representation, right? It's like we put people like me on stage so that other people like me will see me and be like, oh, I feel included. But I'm also really conscious of the students who aren't gay or aren't Asian that show up. What does it mean to them when they see me picking up, a pickaxe and swinging it into the dirt, right? They're not picturing me when they picture the person doing that type of work, oftentimes. So I think it does have a powerful effect for connection, seeing yourself in someone on the stage or someone in a position of power, a peer, someone who shares the same interest as you. But also, I think there's power in learning from and connecting with people who are different than you. And going back to the keynote again, he had mentioned that kind of where you stand often relies on who you're standing with or who you see yourself standing with, who you identify, who you trust. If we keep ourselves siloed in diversity, equity, and inclusion that, oh, this panel is for people of color to be able to see themselves. No, it's so that we all can know each other, connect with each other, because that's how you get people to stand together and stand for what's right.